Welcome back, WNST, Towson Baltimore, and Baltimore Positive. We are calm, we are local, and right now, Don Mohler, I don't put on black and gold very often. Sometimes for Mike Tomlin, usually something to have to do with local universities, and we will talk about things Towson a little later on. But, you know, my favorite campus is over there in Catonsville. And last time, the Don Mohler, former Baltimore County executive, and I got together on Baltimore Positive, three chunky segments broken up by, shrimp and grits, coffee, and more waffles and delicious chicken over there at State Fair. We welcome back on the good doctor, Dr. Freeman Hrabowski of UMBC, along with Don Mohler. We're not at State Fair. I hope sometime we can do more than curbside over there, Doc, but I put on a little black and gold for you here. You know, I know we were right up on basketball tournament time, and
yep,
things took a turn last month, and life has changed for all of us, and you're amongst many we're talking to in the college space, here in university space, that we've talked so much about remote learning. Well, here's trial by fire, right?
Yep, and glad to be here with you guys. It's still special when we get a chance to communicate in any way possible.
Well, Dr. Hrabowski, it's you and I were saying off air, this is really, we're in uncharted waters, and it's hard for me to imagine. When I look at your career, first of all, it's hard for me to imagine that it's almost 30 years at UMBC. Does that compute for you?
It's a special university, and I have been so honored to be a part of that place. I really have. And I mean, what you may not know is I actually moved to UMBC in 1987, the beginning of 87. So I've finished that 30-year period. I've been president since 92, so that's been about 27 years, but I've been there since 87, and I can't think of a better place to be than at
UMBC.
We're
all of us in the state of Maryland, obviously very, very fortunate to have you there to be leading this university. Let's start with the obvious question, Dr. Hrabowski. We're sailing along, and you know, who knows what we knew and what we didn't know. We'll let others sort that out. But all of a sudden, in early March, you wake up one day and you've got to shut UMBC down. Talk to us a little bit about your thoughts, what went through your head, and then what you did to spring into action and deal with it.
Sure. One of the advantages of being in our state as a public university for many of us is that so many of us from UMB and Towson, College Park, and UB are part of the University System of Maryland. And so we're not alone. We are working with our Chancellor, Jay Perman, and with other presidents and leaders to think these things through. And from the beginning at the UMBC campus and at every one of our campuses, our number one thing was safety and health. What do we need to do to make sure our students and then our colleagues, our students, our faculty and staff are all safe in this process? And so it was about listening to advice from experts, looking at the evidence, looking at best practices around the country, and then discussing it with what we call shared governance, with people on the campus, with our student leaders and with faculty and staff, to make sure that what we were doing, people were understanding as much as possible about that process. And that led to our deciding the day that we needed to get people to start moving out as much as possible.
Well, you've had three decades of experience building this university, and I would encourage anyone that wants the whole history to go back to the previous Baltimore Positives from back in the early days last year. Don and I are going to be doing episode 200 later on this week around here, so we're proud of that as well. But
sure,
the legacy that you've had there, there's nowhere in that playbook, and we've talked to CEOs, museum directors, people running all sorts of businesses, banks, there's nowhere in the playbook that says pandemic and what happened. So we're all writing a new playbook right now, and you mentioned for the whole university system it is,
yes,
a playbook, but for you,
yes,
instinct takes over. Obviously, there's instinct that Larry Hogan has had and that Gavin Newsom has had and that Governor Cuomo's, that we've seen this leadership. We've also seen what's going on down at Pennsylvania Avenue as well. And we've seen certain organizations lead, you know, in great ways, in admirable ways. The medical community, the doctors and nurses on the front lines and first responders. But the universities, you know, this was something literally in 48 hours, you had to make very time-sensitive decisions for everyone's safety, especially what was going on in New York at the time, right?
Sure. The one advantage we have in our system right now is that our chancellor is a physician, and my campus, but all of the campuses are close to UMB, which is major public medical center for our state, in fact. That one and Hopkins together make up what we would call the real health strength with other hospitals in the region. But here's the point. So we could get the best advice from some experts on my own campus who are in public health and who look at emergency issues and infectious diseases, but also from the UMB campus, where the medical school and the public health school, where they are talking about these issues all the time. So we have that expertise. The other thing I would say is that our governor has been amazing in this process, and we should all give him credit for that. And listening to the experts and doing whatever was necessary to help our state to be as strong as possible in supporting the health and safety of people. So you think about it, for a university, you've got what the state is saying, the legislature works with the governor, of course, and then you look at what our system is given as its direction and guidance, and then the system works with every campus. And so we were very fortunate to be a part of a larger community. It wasn't just about one president or one set of people on one campus. It was about all of us working together to say, what's in the best interest of the residents of the state of Maryland?
Well, as a leader, and we talk about leadership here so much, a county executive as well, leadership, you just said so. We listen to the experts. I get the smartest people I can find who are smarter than me, especially about infectious diseases, because Dr. Hrabowski's pretty smart, but infectious diseases is not what he studied, you know?
That's exactly right.
You know, listening to experts, that is at the heart of effective leadership.
Yes. And, you know, you mentioned the county executive. You know, we're very proud of Johnny O. He's our graduate. He is a policy expert himself. He knows how to listen to good advice and to the experts and to do the kind of critical thinking necessary on behalf of the people. And so we're very fortunate here in UMBC just to think about, from the county's point of view, from the state's point of view, from our system's point of view, and all those together listening to what's best in the best interest of our students and our colleagues.
Don knows is one of his students, and I'm here taking it. Hold on, let's go back, Don. I'm not going to let you in here yet. Hold on. Critical thinking.
Yeah.
Critical think. Don, when you have critical thinking, people are criticized. You know that, right?
Well, there's no doubt, and you know, it's so interesting when Dr. Hrabowski talks, he's got a proud graduate doing a phenomenal job. Johnny O is county executive in Baltimore County. I know, Dr. Hrabowski, how proud you are. You actually have the Speaker of the House.
Yes.
That's for you on the state side, and Adrian Jones, and Nestor and I could not agree with you more. And I think folks who listen know that we don't hesitate when we think something's not going right to speak that as well. But
sure,
the job that Governor Hogan has done in terms of really, I think, providing a leadership class for the people of the state of Maryland to say, oh, that's what leadership looks like. It's pretty reassuring, isn't it?
Yeah, and he works with the National Governors Group, and I know he's highly respected around the country. So you've got him, you've got our Speaker of the House, but you got a great President of the Senate. We've got excellent legislative leaders. We've got strong county executives, and we have this governor, all working with the same purpose of doing what's best for our children and our families.
Well, Dr. Hrabowski, I know crystal balls are tough, but recently you mentioned Dr. Perman, and we're going to be chatting with Dr. Perman here in the very near future. Mm-hmm. But he announced recently that he's putting together a task force, an advisory group, I think is the way he referenced it, to really begin to look at options in the fall. And for me, that's pretty personal. I've got as you and I have chatted before, I've got a granddaughter who's a senior at Catonville High School. I couldn't get her to go down the street at UMBC. I think she needed to be a little further away
from her
family than at UMBC. So she's heading off to Roanoke, but she's got her fingers crossed. She hopes she's going to Roanoke. So tell me a little bit from your perspective, what kinds of things will go into the decision when you chat with Dr. Perman and others as to whether you welcome your kids back?
You know, the number one thing will be health and safety, and we're having to say this to families because we have more applications now for UMBC than ever before, coming from all over the world with large numbers from this state, but especially from the New York area, New Jersey, all those places. People want to be at UMBC. I mean, it want to be in our state. We are known for public higher education, so I want to give credit to all of our campuses for doing a great job of supporting students. But what we are excited about is these families want to know, what can we do and what's it going to look like? Well, we are working, again, with the system under the guidance of the state. You mentioned Chancellor Perman has this advisory group. I've got two of my colleagues who are on that task force with him, and we will be looking at the issues that you might think about, which have to do with whether or not you have classes, whether or not you have people in residence halls, what are the health and safety issues, and at the top of the list will be just that. What's in the best interest of the safety and health of our students and of our colleagues who are in different populations, at different ages, different health challenges? And what you have to keep in mind is all of us, most places, are waiting before make that decision because we're all connected. We need to see what's happening at the national level. We need to see what level of testing is available. We will need to understand more about the trend in the numbers of cases and the trend in the number of tragic deaths that we're all dealing with right now. All these are issues we have to deal with. The other thing I would say is that we're working very hard to see how to help families right now. We've given refunds back to kids, young people who were in the residence halls for the period when they were not there. We've given them refunds that also include fees that involve things, services they were not getting. For example, if they're not there for parking, we've given that back to them. A lot of universities and other places have not necessarily done that, but our campus has decided to be as fair to families as possible in helping them during this difficult part. And we're also working to see how we can give as much financial aid to people because we understand that families are going through a very challenging time. All these will be issues that are part of the factors taken into account. But again, we can't make final decisions right now because we don't know the state of testing in our state, but also in the country. We don't know yet about kinds of medications that may be available. Everybody's working on these vaccines. And if you don't know it, the person who has moved the needle the furthest in the right direction in terms of developing a vaccine that's now in human trials is a UMBC graduate who leads the team at NIH, and they already have gotten it to human trials at Moderna right now. So we can be very proud that one of our fine scientists who went off and got a PhD and a postdoc is now leading that effort, that the Surgeon General is a graduate from Mechanicsville, Maryland, came to UMBC and then went off to med school and then to grad school at Berkeley, then was the health commissioner in Indiana. He's the Surgeon General. So we've got, and then on the Moderna side, one of the leading scientists there who is doing the human trials, again, is a UMBC graduate. So we've got these UMBC graduates at all these levels, from county executive to the Speaker of the House, amazingly, to the Secretary of Labor for the state of Maryland, to the Chief of Staff of the Governor. So the message in the midst of these challenging times is that universities produce people who can help people. And we are producing large numbers of leaders. I mean, the nurses, I mean, we've sent students down and they finished nursing school down at UMB or over at Towson. But a lot of our graduates are doctors who are on the front line in this state and beyond. And so that's what I want people to understand, that higher education plays a very important role in helping not only in the good times, but in the bad times. Emergency medicine is one of our major, and our faculty are involved in serving as experts on a lot of the task forces around the country and in the state of Maryland.
Dr. Freeman Hrabowski is our guest. He is the president of UMBC, the University of Maryland at Baltimore County, in Catonsville. We tried to bring it to Dundalk, but they wouldn't let us, so Don gets it over there. It's all good.
I can throw a softball and actually hit the campus, Nestor. I
know
we
you can.
We love all of Baltimore County and beyond. We do.
Doctor, so many things I want to circle back on here because I'm taking notes as we're getting here about clear communication and crisis management. And there's one thing you keep going back to, and for the guy who gave many, many speeches and dissertations on science and technology and the four pillars of college success in science,
yeah,
what would your life be like if you woke up tomorrow and didn't believe in science? You know what I mean?
Like, it's such a question for our country and for humankind right now. I would say two things. We need people who appreciate the importance of evidence, of science. But we also, let me just say, need people who appreciate the importance of humanities and social sciences, because there are a lot of ethical issues here. We need people who understand public health. And public health is about, yes, it's science-based, but it also looks at a lot of ethical issues. We've got a lot of challenges involving how do we make sure we're fair to all groups of people, whether they are over 65 or have certain medical conditions, or they're from poverty, or they're from different racial groups. We've got to think about how to prepare our young people to be citizens who can appreciate evidence, but who can also understand it's not about just science and public health. It is about what it means to be a human being and how we support people. And in this tragic time, when we're talking about people losing loved ones, I mean, we need to make sure that our citizens and our leaders have the compassion to feel for families. And so it is both the science and the humanities. And I say that as a math teacher, that we need people who understand the human condition in addition to the science, in addition to listening to the experts as we work to keep families healthy and safe.
Well, you know, Dr. Hrabowski, you talk about this robust thing that I call that is Retriever Nation. I mean, you
yes.
built this network all across the country, all across the world. I mean, everyone knows UMBC. But what I'm struck by, and in the midst of all this, which is very challenging, there continue to be these beacons of light. And what I suggest is one of the real beacons of light is what UMBC, under your leadership, has done in terms of minority achievement and minority enrollment. I mean, I continue to look at the numbers where roughly 18% of your students are African American, another 20% are Asian American, roughly 8% are Hispanic. You lead the country in PhDs for African Americans. So at a time when this whole issue of equity and diversity is front and center,
yes.
UMBC is a laboratory to say, folks, we can do this. We don't have to throw our hands up. It's possible. Tell our listeners how in the world you get this done at UMBC.
Now, I appreciate that. You know, the term we use is inclusive excellence. We love all of our students of all races, and we've got kids from around the world, but most are from Maryland. And one of the things that we say to students all the time is we want you to appreciate who you are in your own background, but we also want you to know how to work with people from all kinds of backgrounds. We need to teach our young people and ourselves how to connect to other Americans and people from other countries in such a way that we support each other. And for us, it's been about expecting the most. My TED Talk talks about high expectations, not just of our students, but of ourselves, and then building community among them and teaching them how to work across groups. Because, you know, what this crisis has shown us is human beings are human beings, first of all. We can all get this disease. We can all die. We can all support each other. But unfortunately, people who are from low-income backgrounds and people from certain groups, whether it's the vulnerable population of older people and this disproportionate number of African Americans, because of other health conditions heavily and because of the challenge of income disparity, all these things have led to some groups suffering even more than others. We all are suffering as we see people die. But what UMBC does is to say, let's figure out how we help people, any child from any background, to excel and to think about, to dream about the possibilities. And so some of these leaders that we are talking about are white, some are black, some are Asian, some are Hispanic. We represent the best of America and the best of humankind. And that's the message that should be one that higher education talks a great deal about. How do we teach people how to work with each other and to have our children, our young people, aspiring to be the best and to know how to look anybody in the face and see another human being?
Well, Doc, you know, it's such an amazing institution. But before, in the spirit of Baltimore Positive, while
yes.
we're talking about, again, these challenges, mm-hmm. tell us before the pandemic what you were excited about, both this year in UMBC, and what's on the horizon, because I know you never wake up today without thinking about tomorrow.
Sure.
Tell us what you were excited about this year and what you were excited about looking down the road, and I assume still are.
Well, you know, I say this to people all the time. When I'm speaking around the country, Maryland is such an unusual state, and this Baltimore region is with so many strengths that we need to talk about our strengths. I mean, the fact is that we have a governor and a legislature that work together. We have county executives who are on it, who understand the importance of K-12 and higher education. And for us, we were looking forward to the funding to support building workforce development, building the university so we could help more students who could become well-prepared and get great jobs and help their families. That's the name of the game. And to be good citizens, to understand the importance of voting. We should never tell people whom to vote for, but we should make sure students are, and people, citizens, are voting and using critical thinking in deciding who they think will be best for our country.
Doc, do you have any idea how many people in your campus vote? I'm assuming...
We had a study that showed we had doubled the number of students, and it was somewhere between 50 and 60% of our students do vote right now. And we were
That's not a good number, 50 or 60%.
Listen, I mean, usually in colleges it's been much lower than that.
Right.
It has gone.
Right.
It's gotten much better. I mean, we're one of the leaders in the country in the percentage of those who vote. But the key is that we were getting those numbers up constantly. We have a number of efforts called Breaking Ground and issues, a center for democracy that's getting more students to want to vote and to understand their vote counts. And so literally since the last election, we had doubled the numbers and percentages, and we're being hailed around the country as one of the campuses known for building citizenship and voting citizens, which I think is so important.
Do you think this time here makes younger people more likely? I mean, I know, you know, older people always get together and say younger people are going to vote, right? I mean, Don and I talked about Bernie Sanders the last couple of years.
Right.
But this period of time where all of us have been quarantined, sent to our rooms to read the internet, maybe
yeah.
learn something about science or about
right.
The difference between, let's say, a bacteria and a virus,
yeah.
Or not to drink Clorox or, yeah. or anything like that.
Sure.
But certainly I would think in the next few months, there should be some sort of a surge on all Americans who would want to vote.
Right? I think if nothing else makes the point to people, the two ideas that when we follow the evidence, we can prevent death. Let's start there. All right, number one. Number two, when we elect people who will support communities and all of our states and our counties as we are struggling right now to help families to be able to put food on their tables, we need elected officials who understand the importance of being compassionate and wanting to support families, people who've lost their jobs, you see. And so while I will say very quickly, I have no right to tell anybody whom to vote for, I will ask them those questions. Do you want people in office who will help states, to help counties and jurisdictions to make sure people can eat, to make sure people get jobs, you know, and to make sure that they are able to take care of their families? I mean, that just seems to me like a human right. And so, I mean, I'm very passionate about that. I just want people just to look at different people who are running for different offices and make those decisions, because we need people in Congress and people at every level, at the state level, national and federal and local, who understand nothing is more important than our families and supporting Amen. Our families and helping their children and themselves.
Amen. For those of you just tuning in, we are with Dr. Freeman Hrabowski, president of UMBC. I've been president now for 28 years, just hard to believe. Freeman, along the way, you may remember that there was a time when Nestor actually talked about sports, when there was sports to talk about. And while it's not at the top of everyone's agenda at this point in time, right when this pandemic hit, I think of big-time college athletics. And you have one of the top young basketball coaches in the country in Ryan Odom.
Yep.
You have always an outstanding lacrosse program
yep.
that was getting ready. It played a couple games, ready for another outstanding season.
Uh-huh.
And all of a sudden...
No, you got to mention Karinji. If you don't mention Karinji right here, don't do that.
How can I forget? Certainly Pete Karinji.
Pete's been the gold standard. People know him and love him. That's right. Our coaches, men and women coaches, have been
wonderful.
I got
to throw Stern. I'll throw them all in there. Yeah, I love them all.
Talk about that moment, and not only from the coach's perspective, because I know how actively you're involved with your students. I mean, anybody
sure.
who's walked that campus, you're not somebody in an ivory tower. You're engaged with kids. So at that moment, when the basketball team that was on a roll and playing its best basketball of the year,
yeah,
when lacrosse is getting ready to take, now you've got to sit down with your coaches and these kids,
yeah,
some of them seniors, and say, guys, it's not going to happen. Talk about that experience and the conversations that you had. Put a human face on that.
Sure. Sure. You know, the best news I can give you is that our coaches and the new head of athletics, Brian, they are all people who are educators. They care about their students. Yeah, we want to win, but number one, we care about our students. And what we all had to say in the midst of excitement about getting more money to help with academics, getting more money to build the university, to help our communities, the number one priority had to be health and safety. And that so whether you're talking about in a family or in a university, in a state, or in our whole country, you know, there are so many things that we all are excited about that go beyond this crisis. And yet, when it comes to life and death situations and a pandemic, you have to help students understand this and all of us understand that the health and safety must come first, because if you can get the health and safety, you can rebuild the economy. You can do all those things. And now, for our students, for those who were excited about the games, for those who had looked so long for commencement, it was a hurtful thing. There's no doubt. And I said this to the students in the video. I felt so badly for those students. They had worked so hard for the seniors on our teams, for the people looking forward to walking across the stage. It was just, and that's at the high school level, but at our college UMBC level and at the grad level. I mean, people, you know, this is something that is like a capstone. It's a symbol of their success. And when it looks like you're taking that away, it just makes things feel empty until you think through, well, why are we doing this? We're doing this for life and death, for health and safety. And it was having people understand this is more serious than anything any of us of our generation, and our generation, the younger generation, have ever experienced, anybody's ever experienced before. But when I say that, this is what I say. Number one, that there will be lessons learned here that will make us all stronger than we ever thought we could be. For the team members, for my graduates, there will be lessons. They will be talking about this to their grandchildren years from now. Everybody knows when you get knocked down and you get back up. That's why we talk about the grit. When you've got that grit and that resilience and you get back up, you may have been disappointed, but you're stronger than ever and you're ready for the next obstacle, because the obstacles continue to come in life. What this teaches us, in the same way that the 2008 situation and the 9/11 and some others before that, even of a different generations, is that if you can keep the hope and keep supporting each other during these times, we can get through this. And that's what the coaches were able to do and say as they keep working with the students, even during this period, because it's hard on students and using technology, and our faculty are working so hard to make the instruction as effective as possible. And yet it takes a lot of courage and grit to keep going through this. And this is what everybody, all of us are learning at right now. We've got great coaches and great faculty working to do just that.
Mental challenge for all of us, right? We're all yep. being tested here.
That's exactly right. That's exactly right. But we can get through this. There's something about hope. We always have colleagues and students who are sick and who have cancer, for example. And I have found that their faith and their mindset that says, I can get through this. I can get through this with help from other people and with my faith, and they do. So often they do. This is what we learn when we go through difficult times.
Doc, always a pleasure to visit with you. Don, any final questions for the Doc while we have him here before we send him back over to you're on a virtual campus at this point, right?
We are a virtual campus. The campus is open virtually. So we are literally helping them with counseling and looking at career opportunities and working with the faculty and students in the classrooms. And as students have challenges, we've got more academic support than ever for tutoring. So we are actively involved, working harder than ever, quite frankly. But this is right now the new normal for everybody. We're having meetings and Zoom meetings constantly and WebEx meetings all day long. But I'm going to say it again. There's something about keeping that attitude of working together and building this community of people at the university as we work to help others beyond the campus. There's something about that that makes us stronger as a nation and as human beings.
Well, Nestor, I always say I always gain a number of IQ points anytime I'm talking with Dr. Freeman Hrabowski. It's always a pleasure. Can't let you go without telling everybody who's listening what excites you about the future of UMBC. Why don't you take us out with that, Doc?
Because I know. Let me tell you, when I've had to go to the grocery store and I have my mask on and I see students here in Baltimore County, whether I'm over in Owens Mills or over in the Cadenceville area at the Giant there, and I see my students and they want to come up to me and say something or shake my hand or give me a hug, and we can't do it because of social distance, I look at their eyes. And, you know, even when you can't see the smile, I think this is a time when we as human beings can look in each other's eyes and we can see the hope. And what gives me such inspiration is as I look into my colleagues and my students' eyes behind masks over their faces, and get you see their eyes, you see each person looking to another for inspiration, for hope. And there's something about that look that says we're in this together. And that's what gives me so much hope, not only for UMBC, but for our country and for humankind, that we're in this together. We understand now more than ever just how connected we are across every possible group you can think of. That gives me hope that we will be stronger and better and clearer about the meaning of being a human being as a result of this experience.
Well, we'll give you an elbow bump virtually from here. We'll get together over at State Fair very, very soon for some shrimp and grits, chicken and waffles, meatloaf, the whole, I'm going all in. We'll do it all right?
You know, and I want you to keep that laughter, because we cry a lot. We eat such tragedy, but my mama used to say, laughter and crying can both be the elixirs. Those are the things that soothe the soul. We need both.
I laugh and Moeller cries.
Dr. Hrabowski, I don't think, you're not going to believe this. Nestor, tell me if I'm wrong. Doc, I don't think Nestor has ever joined you on the roof. Have you ever joined Dr. Hrabowski on the roof?
I've never been on the roof. I don't even know where the roof is.
You got to come so you can see all of the Baltimore area. It is Baltimore positive at its best.
All right, we'll do it on a clear day. How about that?
We'll love it. We'll love it. And that day is coming. You better learn it. A clear day is on its way.
Where I can be 5.5 feet away from you?
That's exactly right.
I hope so. 2 meters for you Europeans. Freeman Hrabowski, he is the good doctor and the president of UMBC, the University of Maryland, Baltimore County. Want to give a shout out to all of our sponsors at State Fair over in Catonsville and Moeller and Gary Realty. If you did not hear Don's son Jeff on, find it out in the buyatoyota.com audio vault. We got together at the beginning of the pandemic to talk about sports and we did have some sports this week. We did some NFL draft stuff. You can find that on the WNST side of things, on the Baltimore Positive side of things. We're getting together with universities, colleges, leaders, museums, all sorts of conversations. And then next week, the mayoral candidates come back here to WNST. We can't wait to get back down to Fadley's, get some crab cakes, get some crab soup. I want some of that mac and cheese, and I want to bake it up in all its deliciousness down in Fadley's. So you can ship those crab cakes anywhere in the world. We appreciate their sponsorship and their unwavering support of all things Baltimore Positive. We are WNST.net. We are keeping calm. We are staying local, and we are always Baltimore Positive.